Good afternoon, good afternoon, good afternoon. What's happening? What's really good? It's time to do this again. What we're going to jump into today is basically what occurred inside labor relations. The employer's labor relations or facilities labor relations office. And we're going to go to the part when the labor relations specialist, when holding a hearing, well, you're being brought up on charges. Okay, fine. Key thing is to the charges was retaliatory charges. Based on the fact that the officer filed a complaint with the facility's EEO, remember, the complaint was first following the employer's corporate compliance plan. As far as procedure, you first tell the supervisor. That would be the two captains. Then after that, the captains referred the officer to the management. Okay, a manager. Human resources, that would be the EEO officer. Okay, facilities EEO officer. Moving forward, the charges of retaliation was time and attendance. Basically, was excessive lateness caused by the director when he gave a directive to supervision and to the parking management not to let the officer in his paid parking parking lot, for which the officer was parking there for 2 years and a month prior to the dirty director being hired. So this occurred within 3 months. So you would say, one, the dirty director's on probation for a year. So said actions to do so would constitute violation of corporate compliance policy. Said actions for him with the way he used vehicle and all of that, and all the laws he broke would constitute gross misconduct, which constitutes on grounds under the employer's personnel rules and regulations. What is that? 3.2.5, I believe. It will fall under the termination of a probationary. Period. Actions of gross misconduct. Termination of a probationary. Period. We're gonna stick back to the labor relations specialist. The labor relations specialist, upon holding said hearing, was told by the officer who was being charged that there was a prior EEO complaint filed with the facility's EEO officer or manager or official. It would have been in the best interest of that labor relations specialist to take and say, let me take a time out, go in the other room, call downstairs, and find out if there was a complaint filed. And what if there's a complaint filed, then technically this Karen basically has to go on standby because there's a possibility that it could be retaliatory charges. And the key thing is, was it a whistleblower? Which it was. So actions for you to not, or for the labor relations specialist to not halt said meeting would constitute improper governmental actions under deceptive practices. That would be improper governmental actions. Under civil service law section 75B, once an employee, a civil servant, has filed a complaint, such as under civil service law section 75B, it states that the public employer can take no adverse actions. None. So, to do so, what constitutes violation of that state law. Civil Service Law Section 75B is a New York state law. Now, in doing so, and you violate that, once the person says it's under whistleblowers, automatically New York State Labor Law 740, which is in your corporate compliance policy, also kicks in under whistleblowers. You do operate within the city of New York, am I correct? So you will fall under the corporation of the city of New York and their guidelines of local law number 33 under whistleblowers. So that's three whistleblowers. We don't even have to go to the federal level. That's three whistleblowers, which governs you and your authority, which basically tells you you have to stop, cease and desist. Yeah, but you continue. Said actions continue what constitutes gross negligence and even gross misconduct based on the fact that you know reason to believe have known not to violate your corporate compliance policy. That would be the A. You are a public servant, am I correct? So as a public servant, now we're going to go from the civil side to the criminal side. Said actions to proceed with constitutes violation of official misconduct under 195-100 penal law. Your actions to do so because you work for a corporation, subsection 2020. Under liability. You hold title in administration. 2025 under liability. Both under penal law codes. The mere fact that you continue to do so with your gross negligence brings about the possibility of one subsection 105.0 conspiracy. You did file documents. Filing these documents, let's go with the first one. The first document aside that was filed was just a punishable document. That would be subsection 210.45, making a punishable instrument filed on the record. Also, filing on the record with fraudulent information, that would be subsection 175.35. It would go to 35 because of the 210. So we're going to go to 175.35, which will make it a Class E felony. That's what it would go to. The key thing is that you were supposed to cease and desist based on Civil Service Law Section 75B and New York State on labor law. And New York City local law. But yet you choose to move forward. I really don't care. I'm just going to do it. Not a problem. Not a problem at all. These negligent acts, basically, are part of deceptive practices. New York State's penal law, business law, 349 and business law 6312. Did you file these documents on the record with other entities? Yes, it did go to 40 rector. So right there, once you filed it with the other entities, go, that would constitute, let's go corrupting the government, right? Let's go back. Let's go to 195.100.05. What would that be? Obstruction of governmental administration? Based on your corporate compliance policy, you know you're not supposed to do that. So that would be obstruction because you're now filing false information and you're using your job. Is that, if that's not the form, the proper form that the governmental information administration is supposed to run? Yeah, that right there, that would be you. Now, the key thing is you filed it with other entities, which it went to 40 rector. That would bring in subsection 496.02. Defraud in the government. Yeah, that's a Class E felony as well. The key thing is, these acts that was going so frequently at this facility need to be addressed. The given parachute by those in position of authority to allow these people to transfer out to other various facilities and then take on other titles. It's unacceptable. Unacceptable. They knew what they was doing was a criminal act. Because under Mayor Order 16, they were obligated to report it. They were obligated to report it. Failure to do so would constitute disciplinary actions and even termination. So on that note, I'm not going to go any further because we got to get the other one from labor relations as well. So let's, in closing, let's go back to that number one deal. The facts cannot be altered nor denied. Y'all have a wonderful day, and I'm out. Later.